Hey, brothers and sisters, this is your favorite brother from another mother coming to you from North Carolina. Hope you guys are all doing all right this Sunday afternoon. Praise the living God for his blessings, brothers and sisters. Praise God, all ye heaven and earth. Hallelujah. Blessed be his holy name. Brothers and sisters, I wanted to share a little bit of wisdom that the Lord has been sharing with me. The topic that we're always talking about is the Lord had put me on YouTube to talk about end times mainly. And so I want to ask you a question. Why is it? Now, everybody always focuses on about the wise virgins. We're talking about the wise virgins from Matthew chapter 25. And people always focus on about, you know, the five wise virgins had enough oil. And the five unwise virgins didn't have enough oil. And we focus on, you know, what is that and all this. But the question that the Lord is proposing in my spirit today is, why do they need oil? What is the oil for? What is the oil for? See, you know, we always have to, the greatest thing that the Lord has showed me about having the wisdom of God. James chapter 1, the Lord says, he who lacks wisdom, let him ask. I love to give it liberally to people who ask me. Is to ask the right questions. And the thing I've learned about the Lord is the Lord will ask you questions. He already knows the answer, but he asks you questions. And so really the secret to wisdom of God is to ask the right questions. So the question is, why do the virgins need oil to go to the wedding? Oh, because it says that at the midnight hour, at the midnight hour, the cry rang out, behold, the bridegroom cometh. So if you didn't have enough oil in your lamp, of course, your lamp wouldn't have any light, and therefore you couldn't see the path to get into the wedding supper. You can't go in the dark. You have to have light to light your path. Now, the Bible says one thing, one Bible verse is that the Bible says, and there's even a song that people sing, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. So the word of God is a light unto our feet, a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. So we need the word of God. And secondly, of course, we need the Holy Spirit. But I want to talk to you, and really this is to the backslidden church, to the lukewarm Laodicean church, those who are the foolish virgins. This video is really for the foolish virgins. Now, right now I'm teaching, but I know the Lord wants me to preach this. So by his grace, by the Holy Spirit, I will preach this. Let me read this to you from Jeremiah chapter 6. Now, this was originally written to Jerusalem before the fall of Jerusalem. But this is to America, to the Western Church, to the Laodicean Church. Jeremiah 6, starting at verse 16. Thus says the Lord, and I preached on this before. The Lord's given me a message along this line before. I made a video about stand ye, thus says the Lord, stand ye in the ways and see, and ask for the old paths. Ask for the old paths. Now we're talking about thy word is a lamp unto the feet and a light unto my path. We're talking about following the path to the marriage supper of the Lamb. We're talking about the wise virgins now. And ask for the old paths. Where is the good way? And walk therein, and ye shall find rest for your souls. But they said, we will not walk therein. It's the Laodicean church in this case. Also, I set watchmen over you. Yours truly, by the grace of God, has been one of those. Saying, hearken to the sound of the trumpet. But they said, we would not hearken. Therefore, hear ye nations, and know a congregation which is among them. Hear, O earth, behold, I will bring evil upon this people, even the fruit of their thoughts, because they have not hearkened unto my words, nor my law, but rejected it. It's the Laodicean church. That's the Laodicean church. Now, when we're talking about the law now, we're talking about the New Testament law. The laws that Christ gave us. The law of loving your neighbor and all those things. I'm not getting into that. Everybody knows my position. If you want to know the position, that doctrinal position I have, you go look at the 14 cardinal doctrines of Assemblies of God. That's a great, great resource and a great standard to begin from when you're developing your understanding and doctrine of the Word of God. So you can start there and get that down, and then you can work from there to see if there's something that you don't see or understand from the Scripture. Anyway, brothers and sisters, so what the Lord was showing me about over the last several days. He'll develop something with me. He talked to me about Trailblazers. Now, not the basketball team, the Portland Trailblazers, but do you know why they call Portland Trailblazers the Trailblazers? I assume, I'm going to assume this because I haven't looked it up. I assume it's because of Lewis and Clark. They went there and, you know, they blazed a trail for the, you know, the European Americans to go out there they were sent as explorers by President Thomas Jefferson out there, and then they made their way all the way out to the Oregon coast. And so they blazed a trail that all the pioneers and all those guys followed over the the ensuing 100 years. People followed the trail that they blazed. And so you've heard that expression, he's a trailblazer. Well, what a trailblazer actually is, brothers and sisters, is, you know, when they used to be the pioneers and all that kind of stuff, and these trappers and, you know, the first people, European Americans to go out west were people who were trappers for furs and this kind of a thing, explorers and all this, like, you know, Daniel Boone and these kind of people. What they did is they would mark the trail. They would put a certain mark along the trail, and then, you know, that this is the right trail to go on. If you get off of that trail, you know, there may be cliffs. There may be, you know, you need to find, like where my family lived for, you know, many, many generations. In North Carolina, there's a place to cross the river there. It's called the name of the road is Shallow Ford Road. So it's a shallow ford of the river. So that was originally and actually an old native trail that went through there. And it was marked that you would be able to cross the river at the shallow ford. As a matter of fact, the British Army came through there. And during the Civil War, the Union Army came through the same place at the end of the Civil War at this shallow ford area. So anyway, that trail was originally blazed. In this case, that trail was blazed by the Indians way, 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 way back, how many long ago. Now, and I just mentioned, I just throw in a little history because, you know, there's nothing that you do that doesn't have a connection with what the Lord wants you to do, brothers and sisters. And I didn't even think about it till just now as I'm speaking. Way back when I was in the Army, when I was a backslider, I read a book. And I don't know why. Now I know why I read the book. And it was the story of the Natchez Trace. The Natchez Trace is an old Indian trail, and now they built like a parkway there, like the Blue Ridge Parkway. They built this Natchez Trace Parkway just in the last 10 or 20 years. It runs from 50 miles south of Nashville. Hey, I'm going to be in Nashville on Friday. I just realized that too. It runs from 50 miles south of Nashville. I believe it's near Franklin, Tennessee, or somewhere in there. And then it runs down to Natchez, Mississippi. Now, that was an old Indian, an ancient Indian trade route. It was a trail that was blazed, you know, hundreds and hundreds of years ago by the natives who used it as a trade route down to the Mississippi River. Now, I'd read a book about that because actually Lewis, see, there's the connection. I just realized it now. Meriwether Lewis, it was a controversy whether he killed himself or someone murdered him there at a place called Grinder's Stand, which is the beginning of the Natchez Trace. And that's one reason why they built the Natchez Trace, because of the historical site. I guess I'm teaching, not preaching, along that Natchez Trace. And I'd read a book. I don't know why, when I was in the Army, we used to go out to these maneuvers and stuff. And I was a medic. And while we were out there, you know, there'd be times when, well, you know, they weren't doing anything. Hurry up and wait, as we say. And, you know, I used to read books all the time. So I'd read this book. And then when I went to the States, to visit back from Germany. And I drove down there to see the place because I'd read about it in the book. Little did I know that I would be referring to it today in 2015 in a video about the old paths of the Lord. Isn't that something? How God operates, everything comes together. So trailblazers. Lewis and Clark, and, you know, as I just said, Meriwether Lewis was either killed or killed himself. It's a debate and a controversy. Most people don't know about that, you know, because they're famous, Lewis and Clark. There in Tennessee, at the head of the Natchez Trail, in a place called, as I mentioned, Grinder's Stand. So, the thing is, brothers and sisters, now let me get into this, because, you know, that's why I'm going slow with it, because it's... It's deep, but those of you who've been watching my teachings, you can kind of follow this. Now, the Lord has been talking to me something, too, about stand to. I mentioned about that 30 minutes prior to sunrise, and there's twilight. We have something called twilight, and I talked about this. I want to talk about it a little bit more because that's where we're in, brothers and sisters. We're in that twilight period. Now, what is twilight? In the morning, there's the first morning light, and it's a different colors. Everything's different colors than after the sun comes up. You get all these beautiful colors at sunset and sunrise. So at sunrise, before sunrise, there's already first light. So you have light. And this is also called a twilight period, where there's light, but the sun's not up yet. And they said, I looked at Wikipedia, and it says that when the sun is either six degrees below the horizon in the morning, you have first light or twilight period until the sun actually appears over the horizon. Now, in the evening, it's the same thing. As the sun would set over the horizon, you have a period that's called twilight before you have dusk. Now, when it's dark, that's dusk. And so you have a period of time in the morning, a period of time at night. Now, what I'm trying to tell you, brothers and sisters, is also yesterday, the Lord had me led me to look at the Twilight Zone, the TV show, the Twilight Zone. I was like, what is the Lord trying to show me? And, you know, the Lord was reconfirming all these things I'm saying, that we are in that Twilight Zone. And not only in the natural could you say we're in the Twilight Zone when you got Catalina Jenner, the former, you know, I could make a laundry list here. You've got the former Olympic decathlon American champion Wheaties poster child of what all things great America, the bicentennial year, set 1976. And in winning this decathlon and all that stuff, and American hero to now, you know, good being called evil and evil being called good, you know, the transgender, confused, baphomatic, spirited destruction of America, you know, and on MSNBC, which the Lord, you know, led me to check it out, they're just glorifying and worshiping him, you know, as the greatest thing since. Greater than when he won the Olympics, you know. This is the Olympics of Satanism, the Olympic Luciferian Olympics. He is the decathlon winner again in baphomatic perversions and twisting of gender and identity in America. And I can make a whole video on these things. You know, as the Lord would give me these ideas and inspiration, brothers and sisters. So this, we are in the Twilight Zone in the natural, you know. I mean, everything is turned upside down, but spiritually speaking, I'm talking about the twilight, you know, and the thing is lots of people are looking at the twilight zone of the natural. And that's what I get owned about on the YouTube videos. Everyone is focusing on the natural things and looking at these natural things. And it's so popular and people want to hear all the bad news and all of this hype about the, you know, things going on in the world in the Middle East and Baphomet Jenner and all these things. But the spiritual things is what I'm talking about. And that's the ministry that God gave me. Praise God. And, you know, it's for he who has an ear to hear. And it seems very sad and unfortunate that lots of people, they can't have, they're not spiritual minded, but carnal minded. They're not, you know, there's, of course, there's many of you who watch my videos who are spiritual minded, but the vast, vast majority of people are Laodiceans, lukewarm, and in carnal minded Christians. And they can't and they don't have an ear to hear. And that's what I'm trying to do with this channel. And another way of saying it, brothers and sisters, by the grace of God, this ministry that the Lord gave me on YouTube is to be a trailblazer but a reblazer. Talk about revival. I'm trying to get you to hear what the Spirit's saying to the church. Thus says the Lord, stand ye in the ways and see and ask for the old paths. Where is the good way? And walk therein. You shall find rest for your souls. But they said, we will not walk therein. Listen, brothers and sisters, that's why the Lord's had me playing, you know, this older music. It's, you know, because, you know, I love modern worship music. I'll put it that way. I don't like Southern gospel music too much. Almost not at all. And I'm not a huge fan of the old hymns, actually. Unless they're sung by an anointed singer, like the ones that I've been playing is sung by anointed singers. So it's the anointing, not the song. But The Lord has had me own that because it's just for this, what I'm trying to tell you now, brothers and sisters. It's a symbol of the old past, even though, of course, what they did 50 years ago, 100 years ago, it's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the old past of the apostles, you know, and the King James. Even though the King James is only like 400 or 500 years old, 1611 and all that, but it points to, you know, the old path back to the time of the apostles, brothers and sisters. That's what we're talking about. So let me tie all this together because I've been putting out all these pieces. In the beginning of the church age, brothers and sisters, they were in the twilight of dawn of the church age. They were in that age when the apostles were walking with the Lord as the disciples. They were in that twilight period, brothers and sisters, when the morning light, there was first light, as it says, the Word of God says in Matthew, when Jesus went up there to the, what they call the Decapolis, which is the region around about the Sea of Galilee. There's another area there, Deca meaning 10, opolis towns or cities of the, you know, former Greek places and Roman, at that time Roman towns. It's called the Decapolis, and it says that, you know, in this area of Israel, a great light, it's an Old Testament verse, and, you know, a great light is seen, you know, in that region of ancient Israel. And it's saying that in Matthew that it's fulfilled when Christ is walking, that this great light is seen. So the first light of the gospel, the first light of the church age, this twilight, morning twilight, first light of the church age was shown when Christ was walking the earth, brothers and sisters. And then, of course, we have the book of Acts, and we're, you know, it's time for the sunrise there on the church with the book of Acts. Well, brothers and sisters, we're in the reverse of that. As it was in the beginning, so shall it be in the end. As it is in the end, so is in the beginning there from Ecclesiastes. There's nothing new under the sun. And so here we are, brothers and sisters, coming to the end of the church age, into the twilight period of the end of the church age. And so that's why what I'm trying to tell you and teach in this video, that we have to go back. And God is using not only me, but you're watching me now. The Lord is using me to try to help you to reblaze that trail. The light, you know, think about a blaze being a burning, a fire, like the oil in the lamp. You know, it's reblazing that fire for the oil to find the path to get to the marriage supper of the Lamb. We have to have that light, brothers and sisters, and that's what I'm trying to do under the unction of the Lord, unction of the Holy Spirit, and by the grace of God, is to show you the path, the old path that leads, as it says right here, Jeremiah 6:16, and you shall find rest for your souls. Thus says the Lord, stand ye in the ways and see and ask for the old paths, where is the good way, and walk therein, and ye shall find rest for your souls. Now we know, brothers and sisters, as I said, there's many who will not. As it says here, we will not walk therein. But those of you who I'm talking to, teaching right now, you will. But I will make another video by the grace of God preaching and rebuking to the lukewarm, to the backslidden, to those thumb downers, you know, those antagonizing children that are not of the Lord, are falling away and all that, to call them to repentance, call them back to the old path, to the Lord. I'll be preaching that one hardcore by the grace of God and by His Spirit later on. Right now, you know, the Lord's Spirit is on me to teach this to you, brothers and sisters. So you can understand what the mission is of the church. You know, our last mission, you know, like the book that the Lord gave me, the message that the Lord gave me that we wrote down in the book. Our last mission, this is what we're talking about. To blaze that trail, brothers and sisters, not only me, and that's why I'm, you know, telling you and discipling you, brothers and sisters, that, you know, there's all of us. I'm just one person. My job is to get you on the right path, and then you call others. I mean, that's how it works. You know, the Lord has put me on it, and the Lord is pointing me to it. So the Lord is using me to point you to it. I mean, that's how the Lord's system works when He has pastors and, you know, and elders in His church. So, brothers and sisters, the Lord wants us to find that old path. And, you know, the apostles blazed that trail from Pentecost for us. And now we're going in reverse. We're going back to that Pentecostal moment. Now, what happened on Pentecost, like I say? For one thing, you know, the church grew by thousands of people at each event. And so now, in reverse of that, the church has a great falling away of thousands at each event. As we have a fork in the road of gay marriage, you know, Baphomet Jenner, you know, people who are supporting Baphomet Jenner who claim they're Christians. You know, all of these different things. These are events like the opposite of what we saw in the Bible. The man was healed at the gate called Beautiful in Acts chapter 3, and then thousands of people joined the church. On the day of Pentecost, thousands of people joined the church when they saw Pentecost. It's reversed, it's reversed, it's reversed, all the way back down the old path until, as I've been saying since I've been on YouTube, the church was mysteriously and suddenly born on Pentecost. And just like on Pentecost, I'm not saying it's that day, you know, there's always one who's actually an enemy of the cross and an enemy of Christ, an enemy of his servants, who will try to put words in your mouth. You know, I've got one or two hecklers, thank the Lord, that's all. But, you know, so that's why, sad to say, brothers and sisters, I want to clarify, because there's, anyway, I'm not saying it'll be on Pentecost, but like on Pentecost, the church was mysteriously and suddenly born with a mighty rushing wind from heaven and tongues of fire, and the church will mysteriously and suddenly disappear. And we call this event the catching away in English, to be snatched up, to be caught up, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16, a.k.a. the Greek word, the Latin word, we get rapture, the doctrine of the rapture, the snatching away as a thief in the night of the bride of Christ, suddenly and mysteriously. That's what the end of the path is, the old path, back to the foundation of our faith, which is the Word of God and the Spirit of God, the Spirit of Pentecost, the same self-spirit that was given on Pentecost. And I've made tons of videos on this, brothers and sisters. Excuse me, if you follow church history, look at church history as a whole of 2,000 years. You know, and I put a graph in that. I keep mentioning about the book. I put a graph in the book. You know, we had the time of the apostles and the book of Acts, and the church was doing good. And then we dipped down through, you know, the Dark Ages and all of those things. And then start with Martin Luther, the Reformation, and the church ages going back. The restoration of Pentecostal experience in 1906. The church has been on a, if you look at the trajectory, the path of the church, and see it for 2,000 years, you will see that the church is on the director, on the trajectory to take it right back to as it was in the beginning. And that will be the moment that the rapture occurs. The amount of people reduces instead of increasing like in the beginning of the church age. It's decreasing. It's going there, brothers and sisters. It's going there. Now, when I made videos talking about revival, and I mentioned this last video, I think I even put it in the title. Then I think I might have changed it. But anyway, the revival, I've said this again and again and again, there is revival coming to the wise virgins. If you haven't already been revived, those who will be raptured, who are part of the bride, have been or will be revived. Now, I've said that in 100 different ways. And let's mention that again, because I have one, at least one, a troll stalker who tries to mince and parse my words. But they will be of none effect. I just want to say this now. And you know, guys know me. I don't get on here and talk about those things. But I want to say this. The arrows of the enemy, the fiery darts of the enemy are of none effect because of the shield of faith. God, I use my shield of faith, and I tell all of you, brothers and sisters, use your shield of faith and let the Lord handle the fiery darts of the enemy. The Lord will be the one to deal with the devil and his children, because there are children of the devil, and they do love to try to seek and destroy God's people. They came to kill, steal, and destroy, as Jesus said in John chapter 10, but I have come to give you life, and life abundantly. So God will give us abundant life in all things, as he told his disciples, in this life and in the life to come, with tribulation. God will give us, he told his disciples, I give you houses and vineyards and all of those blessings in the spiritual and natural, in this life and in the life to come, with tribulation. So we have blessings, but we also have tribulation, the Lord said, because we're his disciples. The world hated him, they will hate us also. That's all part of it, brothers and sisters. So if I come on here, that's the problem with these cardinal-minded Christians are those who are children of the devil who try to, you know, attack God's servants. They can't rightly divide that word. So when you say, if I made a video from the Word of God and said, Jesus said that we're supposed to be prosperous. And then later on I made a video and said, the Lord said that we will have, in this life, we'll have tribulation. They will say that, you know, hey, well, I thought you said we had prosperity. Now you're saying we have tribulation. No, Jesus said you'd have both. And those who don't believe in the rapture will say, oh, Jesus said in this life you have tribulation. He didn't say the tribulation. He said tribulation. All generations had tribulation. Not all generations had the tribulation. Because there's only one generation that will see that tribulation. And that is now. That is now. That is upon us. And no, it hasn't started yet. Don't, I did not say it has started yet. It's about to start. We're in the twilight moments before the start of the tribulation, brothers and sisters. I've got to come back and preach this. The Lord's been showing me all kinds of awesome, cool things about the end times and preaching words. It's awesome, brothers and sisters. I want to thank the Lord. I ask you to come in agreement with me. Let's thank the Lord for His grace, for His mercy, for His love for us, brothers and sisters, because the Bible says that He demonstrated His love for us while we were yet sinners. Christ died for us. That's how God demonstrated His love for us. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. So praise God for that. Blessed be His name. Praise the living God for dying, that the Lord, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in Him would not perish, but have everlasting life. So praise God Almighty, through whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all ye here below. Praise God, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Bless His holy name. God is awesome. So I challenge you, brothers and sisters, you know, that the trail has been blazed by the apostles. We can read that in the Word of God. I'm talking about, number one, there's two things that hold up. That's a whole other teaching. You know, they used to have the tabernacle in the wilderness, and around the tabernacle in the wilderness, they had this, you know, like a gate, a fence, made out of skin. And then on that fence, they had these poles, and then there was a special way they all had to be made. And then there were two ropes holding up each of these poles, you know, every so spaced out along that curtain that was around the whole tabernacle in the wilderness. And, you know, and so just that one part of that, those two ropes represented the Spirit and the Word to hold up that tabernacle in the wilderness, the Spirit and the Word. And so the old paths we have the Bible as a light unto our feet and a lamp unto our feet and light unto our path. And then we have the Holy Spirit to illuminate the Word of God and understanding and illumination of the Word so that we might be able to rightly divide the Word, that we'd have an ear to hear and a heart to receive and the mind of Christ. It all comes by the Word and the Spirit, brothers and sisters. The Word and the Spirit. God bless you guys. I've already been going for a while, and God bless you all. I thank all of you guys who I already sent out, and I asked you, the people who asked for the prayer anointing oil, to email me that or message me that you received it. And the books, Sister Linda Kirby had mentioned something about the book on her newsletter, and I've had several people ordering them. So praise God, and you can, you know, the proceeds go to the orphanages, brothers and sisters at patrickwinfrey.com, so you can do it quickly if you want to. And it's got like a link but it's a love offering. It's for a love offering, brothers and sisters. And the proceeds go for the orphanages and the feeding programs. God bless you guys. I pray that you're filled with the peace of the living God today. May the peace of the living God be upon you. May His grace fill you. May His love overtake you and carry you and deliver you through the trials that you would face this day. As the Lord said, you know, don't worry about tomorrow. Don't think about yesterday, but today. Just know that we overcome daily with our walk in Christ. God bless you all in the name of our beloved Savior and Deliverer, our Lord and Savior, Yeshua HaMashiach. God bless you all in the name of Jesus.